Good evening. Today is February 11th, 2016, which corresponds to the 22nd of the month of Bahman in the Iranian calendar. Today is the 37th commemoration of the Iranian Revolution of 1979. I just gave a 10-minute brief interview to Press TV, and this video is a post-commentary video of what was said on live air. The Iranian Revolution of 1973 was the last populist revolution of the 20th century. It took place in 1979. It was an anti-imperialist revolution. It was a populist movement that brought together different political activists of all sorts of from the full spectrum. You had the socialists, the communists. You had the Islamists. You had the secularists. You had the women that were behind it, and many different groups. The leftists, sort of anti-Shah activists of Europe, and one cannot deny that this revolution was popular in nature. It's interesting that the Iranians are celebrating the 37th year of the revolution because the regime before the current system, the Pahlavi regime, lasted exactly 37 years. The Shah was overthrown from power on this day, but technically this is the day that's celebrated, but he left Iran a few days before February 11th in 2000, in 1979. And so the Iranians are celebrating this day, and it's a very important day. It's important for us to talk about the success of this revolution and also some of areas of its challenge. Every revolution goes through what I call the four stages. And the abbreviation that I use is IGMD. IGMD stands for Introduction, Growth, Maturity, and Decline. The introduction phase of the revolution, or this particular revolution, goes back actually 80 years back. It goes back to the Constitutional Revolution of Iran, which took place between 1905 and 1907, where the powers of the Qajar kings were somewhat put into a system of checks and balances. And after that, you had the overthrow of Ahmad Shah and sort of the usurping of the Iranian throne by Reza Khan, who later became known as Reza Shah Pahlavi. His two-king dynasty ended in 1979 when his son Mohammad Reza Pahlavi left Iran. And he basically became a gypsy. No country would take him, and he finally died in Egypt in 1980. At any rate, the Iranian revolution, so the introduction phase of the revolution really goes back to 7 years prior to that, as I mentioned, to the Constitutional Revolution of Iran between the years of 1905 and 1907. Then Iran went through the second stage of the revolution, which was the growth and the sort of development and the evolution of the revolution. Some people say that the country is still going through that growth stage. It depends on who you talk to, from which political sort of ideology that person really belongs to. The third stage is the maturity stage. This is the advancement stage. This is the full bloom or the cultivation stage of a revolution, and it sort of peaks at that. Now, in a system where the managers, the administrators, the leaders, the cadre who is in charge of the cultural movements of the revolution, make sure the revolution stays at the maturity or the full bloom stage as much as possible. If a revolution is not managed correctly, if it alienates its own population, its own citizens, then it will go into the fourth stage, which I call the decline stage. This is the dwindling stage, this is the contraction stage, this is the decay and deterioration stage, this is the crumble and collapse state of any revolution. For example, we could easily say that the Bolshevik Revolution of 1979 definitely went through the decline state and a complete deterioration and crumble or collapse stage. And this, of course, we all witnessed in 1991 when Soviet Union officially dissolved. Depending on who you talk to regarding the Iranian Revolution, some say that the current or the recent agreement, nuclear agreement, or that was achieved between Iran and the six superpowers, or as they call them, P5 plus one, which comprises of United States, United Kingdom, France, Russia, China, and Germany. Some people argue that as a result of these negotiations and the agreements that were made, the Iranian Revolution really got a boost, and that prior to that, during those 12 years of sanctions, starting with President Ahmadinejad, and the first 2 to 3 years, or the first 2 years of President Rouhani, the current president, that had it not been for the Berjam agreements, that the revolution was on its way to collapse. Some people argue that. Other people say no, Iranian people are a resilient people. The revolution wasn't gonna collapse. They were not gonna let it dwindle, and that it was just a phase that was somehow successfully managed through Iran's negotiations with P5 plus one. But let's go back and talk about the nature of the revolution. What was this revolution trying to create? Certainly, it was an anti-imperialist revolution. It was trying to detoxify itself from cultural, social, political, economic, and military sort of Westoxification. That this is the phrase that is used. This is the phrase. This is a direct translation from the Persian phrase "barbzadegi." It was trying to detoxify itself from many influences of the West. And by West, we are referring to, primarily to the British and the American influence. For those of you who are students of history, you are aware that during the years of World War II, Iran was under the sphere of influence of two superpowers. The northern half of the country was more or less occupied by the Soviet forces, and the southern half was occupied by the British forces. And after the end of World War II, Iran somehow managed to, through skilled diplomacy, somehow managed to kick out these two superpowers out. Again, depending on who you talk to, many people would argue that this, especially the British and the American superpower, were really never kicked out until the siege of the Iranian embassy in 1979. So that the jury is still out on that. But the goals of the revolution were to sort of free the country from Washington's hegemony, from the predatory capitalism that was, had undone itself on Iran, the moral depravity that the Iranian society found itself in, the rampant greed and materialism, the totalitarianism and the dictatorship of the second king, Mohammad Reza, the Shah of Iran, and also the various levels of social injustice, economic injustice, political injustice. When it comes to social and economic injustice, many people argue that there was vast income gaps between Iranians. Again, for those who are counter-revolutionaries, they point out that no, after the revolution, the economic gap, or the vast economic income gap, has become much wider. So it really depends on who you talk to, the advocates of the revolution or the proponents or the opponents of the revolution. Either way, it was an ideological revolution. It was the first theocratic, democratic slash theocratic revolution in humanity's history, because of the nature of the Iranian system, which is a theocracy, a democratic theocracy, as some would argue. So it was very unique in its nature. It really cannot be compared to any other revolution in human history, be it the French Revolution or the Russian Bolshevik Revolution of 1917, or, for example, the Cuban Revolution of 1959. It cannot be compared to any of those. It was a very unique revolution which started a new trend in the Middle East. And those of you who are students of history are aware that Iran is always about 35 years ahead of all the other Middle Eastern countries. So a lot of the ramifications of the Iranian Revolution we are now witnessing in the Middle East, for better or worse. Some people argue that the Arab Spring is a spin-off, is a Western spin-off. And I'm going to talk in the second part of this video and the third part of this video about counter gang and counter or pseudo gang mentality. So I will expand on what the Arab Spring was all about, and in conjunction with the Iranian Revolution. Nevertheless, the Iranian people are known to be the most political people of the world, and it was incredible how this revolution was not. It was a very scholarly, very very academic, and very intellectual type of revolution. Any society that separates its scholars from its warriors will have its thinking done by cowards and its fighting done by fools. The Iranian Revolution, many would argue, was a very intellectual revolution. It was a very scholarly revolution where warriors and scholars cooperated, and as a result, you got what people end up having during the past 37 years. Again, there's a wide spectrum of opinion when it comes to this, but the predominant opinion is that the Iranian Revolution has not reached its decline, it is not dwindling, and certainly the P5 plus one agreement boosted its morale, its popularity and its sustainability. In part two of this video, of this analysis, I will discuss the counter gang or the counter revolutionary or the pseudo gang mentality of what we see in the Middle East today, especially in the form of ISIS, ISIL, IS, or Daesh, whatever name you want to go by. I will try to correlate that phenomenon as a counter sort of movement against the Iranian Revolution of 1979. So please stand by for part two.